Good morning and welcome to church. Well, this morning, if you would, if you've got your Bible with you, if you would open to Romans chapter 14, we're going to continue in Romans this morning. I want to remind you, some of you, those of you that are used to coming to church here at Southbrook Chapel, you know that every week I put your notes in the bulletins. You know, every pastor has kind of their own system, their own way of preaching, and something I adopted many years ago was putting the notes in the bulletin. And there's a couple reasons for that. One is it forces me to stay on track, right? We've got to fill out those notes as we go along. And also I've learned that we learn better when we use all of our senses. And so we learn through hearing, and we also learn through seeing. So if you've got the notes there, you've got the verses there, that you can look at that helps us in retaining more information. And also, if you've got some blanks to fill in, when we write things down, we're actually doing something, we tend to retain more information. So I post these on Facebook. If you like our Solid Rock Chapel page, I post these on Facebook on Sunday morning, so you can download them, you can print them out, and then you'll have them there for you as we get started here this morning. So this morning I've titled my message, The Christian Melting Pot. And the reason for that is, you know, as we look at our church and many churches, it's very diverse. Our church is probably one of the most diverse churches in the community. And we've got people from here from a large variety of backgrounds. We've got people that are former Methodists, people that are former Baptists, Nazarenes, Mennonites, Amish, former Catholics, Disciples of Christ, Church of God, Assemblies of God, Presbyterians, and many who didn't go to any church at all. And now that we're live streaming, there's probably even a more diverse group of people watching these live streams. So as we go along here. So this section of Romans is kind of a continuing commentary by Paul of Christ's command to love one another. We go back to Romans chapter 12, a couple of key verses here I want to look at before we get started in chapter 14 this morning. It says, love must be serving. That's why we're given spiritual gifts, so we can serve each other. We do that through the local church. And we're kind of limited in that now. We can still serve. There's still some things that we can do as we serve each other, even while we're social distancing, but many of those things we need to be here to serve each other through those things. And Romans 12:10 says, be devoted to one another in love. And then, you know, love must be genuine. Romans 13 taught us to be submissive to authorities and so forth. Romans 13:8 says, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. Now we come to Romans chapter 14. Chapter 14 teaches us to be tolerant, to be patient with other people's views. I want you to think this morning about the person that you disagree with the most. And fix that person firmly in your mind. And then let's see what God says about that person this morning. Let's read the first verse of Romans chapter 14. If you've got your Bibles there, it says this. It says, except to one whose faith is weak, without quarreling over disputable matters. Disputable matters. Now, that's not a word that we use a lot. Disputable matters. Something that's open for question or debate. For example, let's take just my view of eschatology, my view of end times happenings. I believe, according to how I read and interpret the scriptures, every person who's put their faith in Jesus Christ will soon be raptured, meet him in the air, right? And then there'll be a seven-year tribulation period, and we'll be with Jesus somewhere during that time. And at the end of that seven-year tribulation period, Jesus will return and fight the battle of Armageddon. And Satan will be bound for 1,000 years after that. He'll no longer be able to deceive the nations, the Bible says. And Jesus will reign here on earth for 1,000 years. At the end of that 1,000 years, Satan will be released for a short period Some think that Jesus won't come for his bride until the middle of the tribulation. Some think he won't come until the end of the tribulation. Some people don't believe in the rapture at all. And that's okay. That's a disputable matter. In fact, I have to remind myself that I might be wrong. Because remember, the Jewish rabbis were looking for Jesus to come the first time. And they totally missed it. They thought they knew how that was going to happen by looking at the prophecies of the Old Testament. But they totally missed it when he came the first time. So let's not get so hung up on those things. So that's my first point this morning. Don't get hung up on disputable matters. Now, there are some things that are indisputable for a Christian. In other words, we all have to agree on them. For example, the deity of Jesus Christ, that he is and was the Son of God. The virgin birth, that salvation is through Jesus Christ alone. That the Bible is the Holy Spirit inspired, infallible Word of God. There are some things that are always wrong for a Christian, like adultery, drunkenness, hatred, murder. We can go to the Old Testament or the New Testament, and we can find that those have always been wrong, will always be wrong for a Christian. But there are some things that are disputable. You may not agree with them, but they are not worth arguing over, is what this verse tells us. God leaves that open for each individual to decide. So let your conscience be your guide. So that's the context here of not quarreling over disputable matters. Let's go to the second verse. It said, one person whose faith allows them to eat anything, but another whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. So there you go, vegetarians. Well, let me be clear. I don't think this is talking about nutrition. This is not. Some of you all like to just eat vegetables because of nutritional value and so forth. And that's fine. I don't think that's what this is referring to here as we read on a little bit later. What was going on in those days was the problem was that there was meat being offered to idols. Now, the pagans would go and they would offer their meat to their idols, and then right beside the temple, there was a meat market. They would go and they would sell their meat in that meat market. Some thought it was okay to eat that meat. Some thought it wasn't okay to eat that meat. On the other side of the spectrum, you had the Jewish people who had been taught their whole life to only eat kosher meat. So there was always a debate. Some thought it was okay to eat the meat that had been offered to idols, and some thought it wouldn't. And you might say, well, that doesn't apply to me today. I don't know anybody that offers meat to idols. Really? Have you ever heard of halal meat? If you've ever eaten in an Arabic restaurant, you have eaten halal meat. Many grocery stores now offer halal meat. In some communities, there are stores that are totally halal. Now, what does that mean? Halal basically means permissible. It's what is permissible. And it's, so what does it take for it to be permissible to make it halal meat? Well, several things. The animal has to be slaughtered by a Muslim. The animal has to be killed by slitting its throat with a knife. The normal way to kill animals in the United States is with a stun gun, where it's very quick, it's very humane, but for them, it has to be killed by slitting the throat and the animal bleeding to death. And then the butcher has to say this, says, Bismillah Allahu Akbar, as he slits the throat. Bismillah means in the name of Allah. Allahu Akbar means Allah is greater. So the butcher is sacrificing the animal to Allah while saying that Allah, or Satan, is greater than the God you serve. So is that a problem? So should you eat that meat? You probably have and didn't know it. For example, you ever eaten a Butterball turkey? In 2011, Butterball made the decision to make all their turkeys halal. Now they got a lot of pushback from the Christian community, so they stopped that practice in 2013. This debate had been going on for a while. For the new church, the Christian. In fact, there was a dispute among the early church back in Acts chapter 15, and that as more and more Gentiles became believers, some people thought that they had to become Jews to become believers, become followers of Jesus. So they had this convention where they got together in Jerusalem and they talked about this. And James stood up and he said this. He said, "It is my judgment, therefore, that we should not make it difficult for the Gentiles who are turning to God. Instead, we should write to them, telling them to abstain from food polluted by idols, from sexual immorality, and from the meat of strangled animals, and from blood." So this was James saying, you know, at that point he was saying, you know, maybe we shouldn't eat that meat. But then what about if you eat the meat off the idols and you're not aware of it? What if the meat you're buying in the store has been sacrificed to Allah, and you bought it and aren't aware of it? Well, they address that as well in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, where he says, if an unbeliever invites you to a meal and you want to go, eat whatever is put before you without raising questions of conscience. But if someone says to you, "This has been offered in sacrifice," then do not eat it, both for the sake of the one who told you and for the sake of conscience. I'm referring to the other person's conscience, not yours. But why is my freedom being judged by others' conscience? If I take part in the meal with thankfulness, why am I denounced because of something I thank God for? So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Do not cause anyone to stumble, whether the Jews, Greeks, or the church of God. So what does it say? He said, if you're invited somewhere, eat whatever's put out in front of you. Don't ask questions. If your host says, "This was offered to idols," he says, don't eat it because of what it does for them, for their conscience, not for yours. Because they don't really expect you to eat it. Some things to consider. So, he says here, it's for their conscience, not for yours. He said it's permissible for you to eat whatever you want. I want you to notice that he refers to the freest person as the one who is strong in the faith, and the most restrictive person as the one who is weak in the faith. You know, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The mark of understanding truth is freedom and liberty. The person who doesn't understand the truth of the grace of Jesus Christ, is always wanting to put restrictions on, always wanting to earn their way through restrictions. You know, the church throughout history has become known as the church of no. Don't do this and don't do that. It's often the weak in the faith that are the majority, so that they come up with these rules and regulations and apply them to everyone. I remember back when I was one of the churches we went to years and years ago when I was a kid. They had this rule book, and you had to follow the things in this rule book. One of the rules in that book was you had to drive a black car. You could have cars, but they had to be black. Well, as a teenager, my first car was a real nice Plymouth Roadrunner, 1973 Plymouth Roadrunner. I mean, it was green. It had a nice black racing stripe on the side and went up over the back. I was so proud of that car. In fact, I saved up my money and I bought some chrome Crager wheels and put on that car. And I was really proud of that car. And but, you know, they gave us a grace period of about 6 months, and then it was time to, the bishop said it's time to paint that car. It had to be black. I just couldn't bring myself to paint that car, so I traded it off and got a black Chevy Nova. And we look at that today and think, that's crazy. That's crazy. The world from the outside looking in says, I want no part of that. The thing that the church thinks somehow makes them more holy becomes a thing that is a stumbling block for someone in the world to hear the gospel. We look at our community, the most extreme in our community, of course, are the Amish. Now, some Amish have a great relationship with Jesus Christ, and they choose to live that simple lifestyle because they believe it helps them be a better Christian. There are others that have totally put their faith in their lifestyle and don't have a clue what a relationship with Jesus is all about. Someone said this, the definition of a legalist is someone who lives in mortal terror that someone somewhere is enjoying himself. Now let's go on and read a few more verses here in chapter 14, verse 3. It says, the one who eats everything must not treat with contempt the one who does not. And the one who does not eat everything must not judge the one who does, for God has accepted them. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? Do their own master servants stand or fall? And they will stand, for the Lord is able to make them stand. So here's my second point this morning. Do not judge those with different conviction than mine. Okay? We have to be careful not to judge others with different convictions than ours are. See, the one who's really, truly strong in the faith will not put down a person who is weak in the faith. He will respond with love and encouragement. And why not? It tells us here in verse 4, they are not my responsibility. They're not my responsibility. It's not my responsibility to judge them. The second point is, they answer to God. They answer to God. It says, to their own master, servants stand or fall. You know, we're all in the process of change, and the Lord will do it. It's not your responsibility. It's not my responsibility. Be patient. Let the Lord change them. And the next point is, God is able to help them. It says, for the Lord is able to make them stand. So it's not your responsibility. It's not your responsibility to try to shape everyone around you, try to get everybody around you to do like you do, to feel like you do, to have convictions like you do. It's not your responsibility to do that. We're all different. We come from different backgrounds. We're raised in different environments. We have different levels of spiritual maturity. We're all different. He's telling us to be considerate of that when we come together. So we're all on this journey of spiritual growth. So basically what he's saying is, cut each other some slack. Which brings me to point number 3. I must follow my convictions. Verse 5 says this. One person considers one day more sacred than another. Another considers everyday life. Each of them should be fully convinced in their own mind. So I must follow my convictions. Now I say that carefully because your convictions can be totally wrong. But I believe this is for the person who is honestly seeking God. The Holy Spirit will speak to your spirit and tell you what to do. The Holy Spirit will never tell you anything that is contrary to His Word. And you say, well, won't God tell everybody the same thing? Well, no, He doesn't. Remember, Jesus told Nicodemus to sell everything he had and give it to the poor. He didn't tell the centurion the same thing. It was specifically for Nicodemus because he knew Nicodemus had a problem with his wealth. And for another person who has great wealth and has learned to use it to glorify God, that may not be a problem. And he wouldn't tell that person to get rid of everything he has and give to the poor. You know, sometimes people come to me for counseling, and I may tell two different people to do something totally different because of the situation, because of personalities and so forth and circumstances. See, God can read hearts. You cannot. Let's go on to verse 6. It says, whoever regards one day as special does so to the Lord. Whoever eats meat does so to the Lord. For they give thanks to God, and whoever abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God. Okay? Some of you work on Sunday. Some of you don't. You wouldn't even think of it. I don't work on Sunday. Now, I'm not so religious that I believe that you will go to hell if you go to do some work on Sunday. But I do believe God designed your body in such a way and your mind in such a way that you need a day of rest. You need a day, a week to take a break. Jesus said the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. And I guarantee you will get more done, more accomplished in 6 days and feel better than if you worked 7 days. And God's not so much concerned about what you do or don't do as He is in why you do or don't do something. See, the important thing is, are you doing what you do? God, or are you doing it for selfish reasons? Let's read a couple more verses, verse 7. It says, for none of us live for ourselves alone, and none of us dies for ourselves alone. If we live, we live for the Lord. If we die, we die for the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Here's my fourth point this morning. Relationships are more important than lifestyle. Relationships are more important than lifestyle. Jesus taught the principle of freedom through denying yourself and living for others. Mark 8:34, so it says, then he called the crowd to him with his disciples and said, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Some of you have come to realize how important relationships are because of our current situation. Some of you have been, you know, staying in your home like you should and all that, and have realized what you took for granted before. You know, we don't realize what we're missing until we don't have it anymore. And relationships are very, very important. Fortunately, we do have Facebook, we have telephones, we can still stay in contact to a certain amount. Here's a fifth thing. God alone is the judge. Verse 9 says this, for this very reason, Christ died and returned to life, so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. You then, why do you judge your brother or sister, and why do you treat them with contempt? For we will stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will acknowledge God. God alone is the judge. Stop trying to take his place. He's the judge, you're not. So what are we to do? How should we respond to someone who practices our Christian faith a little differently than we do? Well, look at verse 13. He says, therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in the way of a brother or sister. Number 6, don't be a stumbling block. Don't get so hung up on your way of thinking that you develop an attitude about it and you become a stumbling block for someone else. There are some things that the Bible is very clear about. There are other things that it isn't. They're disputable matters. They're not so clear. For example, people ask me, is it wrong to smoke? Is it a sin to smoke? The Bible never says it's wrong to smoke. Someone asked the pastor that once, said, will I go to hell for smoking? And the pastor wisely said, well, no, but you just smell like you've already been there. Okay? And I've noticed that most church fights and splits aren't about sound doctrine, like the virgin birth of Jesus or salvation by faith in Jesus alone. Most church fights and splits are over disputable matters. Disputable matters. A couple of my favorite stories of one church split over this little praise word that we use all the time, hallelujah. They split over the spelling of hallelujah. It seemed like the problem arose when this church decided to put up a banner in the front of their church that bearing the word hallelujah. Some thought it should be spelled hallelujah with an H, and some thought it should be spelled hallelujah, A-L-L-E-L-U-I-A. So, in fact, this got so wild and so crazy that one person was in his home one night, and a rock came flying through his window with the word hallelujah printed on. And it got wild. Both sides were animated since they'd grown up with one particular spelling or the other. And one person said, I was so sick that I couldn't even sleep. So the two churches split, and now they meet in separate auditoriums. And each has fastened a banner to suit their preference. And one parishioner said, worship is so much better. One of my favorite stories is church splitting is from the Presbyterian Church in Centerville, Georgia. Centerville, Georgia had a population of around 5,000 people, and it all started with the original Presbyterian Church that had an internal conflict around 1911 over whether to take up the offering before or after the sermon. The splitting off church became known as the Centerville Reformed Presbyterian Church. Just 4 years later, another church split occurred over whether to have flowers in the sanctuary or not. The church that split off was renamed Trinity Reformed Presbyterian Church of Centerville. A total of seven more splits happened between 1950 and 1929 over various issues. And by 1931, the latest edition was named Third Westminster Trinity Covenant Presbyterian Reformed Church of Centerville. Much more church splits occurred from 1931 to 1975 over the conservative and liberal arguments that were going on within the denomination. Since 1975, a few more church splits over various issues have brought the total number of church splits in that one town, in that one denomination, to 48, apparently a record. The last one was over whether or not it was a violation of the Sabbath day to check your email. The church split over the issue. Some folks left the 2nd Street, 1st, 9th Westminster Covenant Reformed Presbyterian Church and renamed the new church the Presbyterian Totally Reformed Covenantal Westminster Sabbatarian Regulated Credo Communionist Amillennial Presuppositional Church of Centerville. Now that's kind of a funny story. But how true it is that so many of those happen over disputable matters. And what outsiders think when they hear about these things? See, those Christians fight all the time. It's more peaceful at the local bar than it is at church. Because of disputable matters. Disputable matters. Let's see what the Apostle Paul says as we continue here, reading some more verse 14, it says, I'm convinced, being fully persuaded in the Lord, that nothing is unclean in itself. But if anyone regards something as unclean, then for that person it is unclean. If your brother or sister is distressed because of what you eat, you're no longer acting in love. Do not by your eating destroy someone for whom Christ died. Therefore, do not let what you know is good be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Because anyone who serves Christ in this way is pleasing to God and receives human approval. Number 7, be an example of peace and mutual edification. Verse 19, let us therefore make every effort to do what leads to peace and to mutual edification. Peace and mutual. So ask yourself this morning, what you're doing, is it bringing peace and mutual edification? Or is it something else? Verse 20. Do not destroy the work of God for the sake of food. All food is clean. But it is wrong for a person to eat anything that causes someone else to stumble. It is better not to eat meat or drink wine or do anything else that will cause your brother or sister to fall. So whatever you believe about these things, keep between yourself and God. Blessed is the one who does not condemn himself by what he approves. But whoever has doubts is condemned if they eat, because their eating is not from faith, and everything that does not come from faith is sin. So in conclusion this morning, I just want to say, as we look at the melting pot that makes up the church, we have to ask ourselves, am I contributing to the peace and mutual edification of the church? Or do my actions and attitudes contribute to division and differences and arguments and strife among our members? How do I feel about someone who thinks differently than I do? How do I feel about someone who looks differently than I do? Am I a building block or a stumbling block? I have to tell you, I'm a bit concerned about how we transition back to meeting together as a church. How do we transition from what we're experiencing now, isolated in our homes, to coming back and meeting in this now empty sanctuary? How do we do that? What if our social distancing of 6 feet away. Now, many of you that come to our church, you know that on most Sunday mornings, it's pretty full in here. It would be pretty difficult to practice that 6 foot social distancing here in our church. And how do you social distance a group of 5-year-olds in kids' church? How do you do that? And so I expect we'll see some different opinions and so forth. Some of you are so anxious to get back, you don't care. You're going to come back no matter what. And I understand that. Some of you might have a little more fear because, you know, you're afraid you get the virus. You don't want to get the virus. I understand that as well. So I just want to put out a word of caution as we face that soon. Let's be conscious of other people's ideas. And remember, those are disputable matters. And we'll all get back sometime. We don't know when. But let's look forward to that. And let's remember to keep the main thing the main thing. What's the main thing? Jesus Christ is the Son of God. There's still a lost and dying world out there that needs to hear the gospel. And let's do what we can to continue to share that gospel to the people around us, because He is coming soon. How about that? I got an amen from the crowd this morning. How about that? Awesome. My crowd of two. And so, all right. So God bless you all. Have a great day. I'm going to close in prayer. And look forward to seeing you all in here again soon. All right? Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for your word. We thank you that even though there are many differences among us, there are some things that join us together. And we can decide to overlook some of those differences as disputable matters. They're really not part of the big picture. They're just stuff that Satan tries to distract us with. And Father, as we look forward to coming back together, I pray, God, that you would guide us through that. Lord, I especially want to lift up the leaders of our nation. I lift up President Trump and the governors and others in office who have a tremendous, tremendous responsibility right now in navigating through this pandemic. And Father, I just pray that you give them great wisdom as they do that. I pray your blessing on each one today as they enjoy their Sabbath today, whatever that is for them. I pray that they would have special family time today, or whatever they're doing today, that it would be a blessed day. We just pray this in the precious name of Jesus.